Welcome in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ to Great Grace Church in Chester and Osmond Board. We're starting very promptly today, a little bit earlier than usual, just because it's Remembrance Sunday, and so at 11 o'clock we're going to mark that with the 2 minute silence. It's great we have our friend Stephen with us. And good to see Ruby here after she had a fall. Also this week, Wednesday, 6 o'clock, meet here and we'll do that. And I don't think there's any other special things on. Tonight, 8 o'clock online, if you want to join with us, and then we'll take have a look at outreach possibly. We'll take a moment and see how that goes. So actually, it is, just checking on my phone, it is 11 o'clock. At the going down of the sun in the morning, we will remember them. Yeah. Heavenly Father, we just thank you, Lord, today that actually we can have our freedom today. Mm-hmm. Thank you, Lord, that we have the freedom to express, the freedom to protest, the freedom to live our lives in peace. Thank you, Lord, that freedom has been paid for by those who lost their lives in battle. In your word, there are many conflicts, many victories. And Lord, today we want to join with people around the country and people around the world just to think of those that have lost their lives. We think of the families of those that bereaved, families that maybe lost someone, families of people who maybe had their lives changed through conflict, through injury, disability, stress. We just thank you for the sacrifice that people have made, and we pray for those people. We pray for those that are mourning, that those that are hurt. And Lord, we ask that they would discover you as their Saviour, as their peace. There is no other peace in the And Lord, we just commit people into your hands. Lord, we want to pray today as well for our friends in Ukraine, in Cherkasy, in Lviv, in Kiev, in Odessa, where we have churches, Lord. And we just think of the ongoing conflict there, Lord. We think of pastors that we know in Russia as well, Lord. And Lord, we ask for deep wisdom there for that conflict.
Yes, God.
And we pray for a resolution to it very soon. And Lord, we think of Israel today. As your word tells us, we pray for the peace of Jerusalem. And in doing so, we are praying also for those that are against Israel. We think of Palestine, the suffering of the people there, Lord. And Lord, we ask that you would just show deep compassion. And again, that people would find in you the answer to their needs, the answer to their problems. We pray for the leadership there also. And we pray for deep wisdom. And we pray for those that have had their lives destroyed through this. Again, Lord, we just give that situation into your hands. You are the only one that has the answers. And we look to you, Lord. Many people can have opinions. But Lord, the Lord Jesus Christ, the Savior, the Messiah, is the answer. Whether people on either side will accept that, they have the freedom of that choice, Lord. We give this into your hands now. You're a loving God, you're a loving Father, and we trust you now. In the name of our Lord Jesus Christ. Amen.
Amen.
Okay, so today, as I said, we have things slightly differently. My phone away because I was timing the silence. We've given the announcements. We will pray over the boxes. We're going to look at a short video. So let's do this. Let's pray for our service now, and then we'll worship together. So, Heavenly Father, we thank you, Lord. Thank you for your goodness and your faithfulness to us, Lord. Guide us today, Lord. Fill us with your life and your spirit, Lord. Help us to worship you in spirit and in truth, in freedom, in the beauty of holiness, Lord. And just lead us now, Lord, we pray. We ask that you touch for those situations that are on our hearts, Lord. We thank you for Ruby being here, for healing, Lord, there. We pray for Noble as well, Lord, and for other ones that can't be here, Lord, today. We were different ones, Tony and Vivian, Mary, Supani in Thailand at the moment, or Southeast Asia, Lord, and various other ones as well. Just minister your life, Lord, and touch for Hayley and Jane. And Phil Brown as well, Lord. And minister your life, Lord, we pray. Be with Anne's family, Lord, we pray for Julia and the whole situation.
Yes,
Lord. Just really come through, Lord. And for any others that have loved ones, for Mary's mother as well, Lord. Sarah's father. Come through, Lord, we pray, at this time. Thank you, Lord. Thank you for your faithfulness. Thank you, Lord, for coming to the cross for us. Thank you, Lord, for caring for us, Lord. Guide us today. Fill us with your life and your spirit, and anoint our service now in Jesus' name.
Amen.
Okay, let's try a worship song of two, shall we?
Thank you.
Yes, Lord, we just want to praise you today, Lord. Thank you. Thank you that you're a faithful God. Thank you that you're a God of love, a God of mercy, a God of care, Lord. Thank you, Lord, we are able to bring our issues, our problems, our insecurities, our failings, our weaknesses, Lord. We bring them to you today, Lord. We leave them there. Because you are the God who can deal with these things. You are the God who has a provision for these things. Thank you, Lord, that we can say today we are forgiven. In the name of our Lord Jesus Christ. Thank you for the life that you give us. Fill us as we continue to worship you now. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
Thank you.
written many years ago. Thank you, Lord, for words of life, words of praise. Guide us today, Lord, by fill us with your life. Fill us with your spirit. Challenge our hearts, Lord. Speak to each one of us, Lord. In the name of our Lord Jesus Christ. Amen.
Amen.
That was a good old hymn. There we go. Did you?
That's
nice. I haven't heard it for a long time, but don't know why. Just dog it out for a change. Now we have on the table behind us there. I don't know, can they be seen on the? Oh wow! Good to see you. on the table behind us here, we have the gifts. Can they be seen on the camera?
Yes.
Yeah, that's good. These are gifts. If many of you were here on Wednesday, it was great. Jim did a Bible study. Thanks for that. Just to get together and pack the boxes, wrap them up. They're all very beautifully wrapped, coordinated, paper. And they're all full of toys and goodies. And there are still a few extra things to put in, I think. Diane's been busy making some more pencil cases. So there's more to go in there as well. What we will say is, there is a box at the back. Do you want to speak about that? Or should we do the video?
Yeah, do the video, because it explains
what we'll
it
do is, let's do that. We'll run with the video first. This is just a little bit more of information. We did play a video a few weeks ago, but this one gives a little bit more definition and detail of what happens with these boxes, where they go, and why we are doing this.
Overjoyed, you can see them shouting, jumping.
Wi-Fi.
This is the first time those children are receiving their shoeboxes. They are so happy.
You can hear the laughter, you can hear the cheer, the excitement, it goes and goes and goes.
Right now we're at Indian Point, and today we're giving out the 200 millionth shoebox to a little girl here. So it's a lot of fun. It's a privilege for us to be able to come and to help the people as much as we can. Every box is important because every box is an opportunity to tell a child about God's love, about His Son, Jesus Christ.
There's so much joy that one gift box can give. They really experience the love of Jesus.
Shall we celebrate something as simple as a shoebox because God uses it to share the gospel of Jesus Christ.
We got a full box on this gift. This is such an amazing time. We're so happy to be here. This shoebox gift will impact the child's life all year round.
We never dreamed you'd have an army of men and women who would come to make this program happen.
This is what it's all about. Telling others about Jesus.
Shoeboxes go to 120 different countries where pastors and missionaries are going to use them to bring the gospel to kids. So you may think it's just a simple gift at Christmas time, but it's the gift of the gospel, the story of Jesus Christ.
When that shoebox leaves that distribution center and it goes around the world, that's not just one person. That's the body of Christ joined together delivering the good news of the gospel.
They go by plane, they go by ship, they go by riverboat, they go by camels, they go by motorbikes. And these boxes go to some of the most remote areas of the world. And every box counts.
After receiving shoeboxes, children are invited to participate in the Greatest Journey Discipleship Program.
These children have just completed 12 lessons in the Greatest Journey. I believe that discipleship is the key, and they are now followers of Christ. They will tell their friends about Jesus.
My friend Kemi told me I needed to go with her to church. I wanted to teach her about the Word of God. And when she came to my church, she received a gift box. For a long time, I asked my mom for a blanket. When I opened my shoebox, I found a blanket in it. When I came home, I showed it to my mom, and she said it was great. I told her about Jesus. Now me, my mom, my grandma, and Kemi go to church together. I am certain of one thing. God is my savior.
Every box counts. Every box touches a child.
It's like a snowflake. There's not one shoebox that is the same. And we are reaching millions of children with the gospel of Jesus Christ.
The heart of the parents, you will reach the heart of the family, and then you will touch the community.
We are seeing churches being planted, and more churches are being built.
We will do whatever it takes to reach the ends of the earth with the gospel.
That gift box is the beginning into their hearts. Isn't it incredible how these gifts touch the lives of these children? The joy, the smiles, it changes lives. Every year we see tens of thousands of children discipled. And we couldn't do this without you, so thank you for packing the boxes. Thank you for praying for these children around the world. God bless you, and keep packing those boxes.
Women don't appear to age?
That's me!
That was just about
Yeah, that was just about Ruby.
I'm the youngest kid. I tried it for myself. Thousands of people have now been doing this. And I've been seeing it all over TikTok.
Of course you are.
There we go.
You're all over TikTok now.
But what I was going to say, if anyone wants to contribute to actually sending them, because actually you can send them for free, they don't actually ask for any money at all, which is amazing. So you drop them off at various places that will send them to the distribution centres in the UK. But obviously, as we all know, when we go to the post office, things cost to actually get them there, get them through customs, all those things. And actually, to get so the child has a Bible and is able to do the discipleship program, which is called The Greatest Adventure, that just costs a little bit. It's only £5. And, you know, so if anyone feels led to, there's a little box at the back that says Samaritan's Purse, but there's no pressure. We can send them, they're amazing, you can send them for free, you know. But you know what? My heart is very much, and it's like, for them to hear about the gospel. It's not just getting a box. It's about actually hearing about the gospel, because that's what's going to change their hearts, going to change their situations, change their lives. So it's up to you guys, but there is that at the back. So that's covered.
So what we'll do now is we're going to pray for these boxes before they get sent. And then we'll take our regular offering for our church. So don't get confused. Box at the back if you want to contribute to this. This will be for our regular offering. But then, so Heavenly Father, we thank you, Lord, for the faithful men and women of God in our church who have donated toys and gifts and took the time to wrap these boxes. Our hands on them now, and we pray over these boxes. We pray that whoever receives them, wherever he is, whatever country, whatever their situation, that it would be a blessing to them, not just to receive a physical thing, blessing that would touch their hearts, and that they would understand that they are loved.
Yes.
They are loved by people around the world, but they are loved by the Lord Jesus Christ. That there is a God who accepts them, forgives them, and wants to be their Savior, wants to be with them throughout their whole life. Lord, we pray that these children that receive them will take decisions for you. We pray that you would raise them up, that they would tell their friends, their family, about what they've received. We pray as they receive maybe Bibles and the discipleship little course. Thank you, Lord. It's done for children. It's a nice little gentle way to introduce them to the Savior. Lord, we pray that you would really speak to hearts. Use it in their lives. We pray that you'd raise up future pastors, future missionaries, future church members through this, Lord. That's our heart. That's the heart of the people who send it. That's the heart of the missionaries who receive it, the other end as well, Lord. And we just give you this time now. We give you each of these boxes and the hearts of the children that will receive them. In the name of our Lord Jesus Christ. Amen.
Amen.
And Lord, we just pray for our own offering now. Bless it and use it for your glory's sake. Thank you. Bibles out if you have them, scrolling through your phone, that's your Bible. And we're going to look at 2 Corinthians chapter 5. Not quite sure how we'll go today. As ever, we give these things to the Lord and he just does with it what he wants. Never quite sure how things will go. Not even really quite sure why we're reading this passage today, but we'll see what God does with it. this is the great thing about the Spirit of God. He's alive. He ministers to us. So let's read from verse 14 of chapter 5, 2 Corinthians. And it says, "For the love of Christ constraineth us, because we thus judge that if one died for all, then were all dead. And that he died for all, that they which should not henceforth live unto themselves, but unto him which died for them and rose again. Wherefore henceforth we know no man after the flesh. Yea, though we have known Christ after the flesh, yet now henceforth know we him no more. Therefore, if any man be in Christ, he is a new creature. Old things are passed away. Behold, all things are become new. And all things are of God, who hath reconciled us to himself by Jesus Christ, and hath given to us the ministry of reconciliation, to wit, that God was in Christ reconciling the world unto himself, not imputing their trespasses unto them, and hath committed unto us the word of reconciliation. Now then, we are ambassadors for Christ, as though God did beseech you by us. We pray you in Christ's stead, be sin for us, who knew no sin, that we might be made the righteousness of God in him. Let's also just read from John chapter 9. In the first three verses of John 9, it says, "And as Jesus passed by, he saw a man which was blind from his birth. And his disciples asked him, saying, Master, who did sin, this man or his parents, that he was born blind? Jesus answered, Neither hath this man sinned, nor his parents, but that the works of God should be made manifest in him." Heavenly Father, we thank you, Lord, for these words today. We just give you this time now, Lord. We have no words of our own. We have nothing to say. But Lord, we ask for the Spirit of the living God, the Holy Spirit, to anoint, to fill us now, to anoint every word, every utterance, Lord. Fill it with your life. Fill it with your Spirit, your peace, your truth, that we would know your heart today, Lord. Touch us, challenge us, Lord. Thank you, Lord. We stand before you now. In the name of our Lord Jesus Christ. Amen.
Amen.
I didn't really cotton on when I was studying this last night, but actually, it's talking about laying down of life, isn't it? I am only just realising now why the Spirit of God wanted me to speak about this. you know what? It's remembering something. Many people are focusing on laying down of life today, aren't they? You know, and we've remembered those that have been lost. And it is a big thing. It is a big thing that even the world now still remembers that, laying down of a life. The Lord Jesus Christ, it says, "For the love of Christ constraineth us, because we thus judge that if one died for all, then we're all dead." Well, the Lord Jesus Christ died for everyone. It was different, wasn't it? He died for all. They which should not henceforth live unto themselves, but unto him which died for all and rose again. That's the difference, isn't it? That is the difference. That yes, many people have laid down their lives, and we are thankful for that. Christian life is a calling to lay down our life for the brethren. Where's that? That's 1 John 3:16, I think. Let us also lay down our lives. And it's like, wow. But the thing is, our Saviour, he laid down his life for mankind, for everyone. But he became sin. That last verse, he became sin for us, that we could become the righteousness of God. Well, do you feel righteous today? You feel special? You feel very good? No, none of us do. It's not our feelings. It's not our feelings, is it? We know our heart. We know how sinful we can be. We know what we're like most of the time. But the Lord Jesus Christ was made sin for us. Wow. That we could be made righteousness. That's incredible, really. Wow. This, I not quite going the way I thought it would, but praise the Lord. I like it when that happens. It's better. We trust on the Spirit of God. Wednesday night we were here and we're looking at the John 4, the woman at the well, weren't we? We were talking about expectations and how actually, yes, we didn't actually get onto the story because it was just about Jesus meeting a woman at the well and all of the history that went with that meeting at a well and what that meant. And all of the history and Genesis of, you know, different people and what were the expectations. But I was thinking about that. We didn't quite get onto the story of it, but just today, thinking about this, the woman says to him in John 4 and verse 20, "Our fathers worshipped in this mountain, and ye say that in Jerusalem is the place where men ought to worship." Jesus said unto her, "Woman, believe me, that the hour cometh when we shall neither in this mountain nor at Jerusalem worship the Father. Ye worship you know not what. We know what we worship, for salvation is of the Jews. But the hour cometh, and now is, when the true worshippers shall worship the Father in spirit and in truth. For the Father seeketh such to worship him." You know, there's a lot of conflict, isn't there, over worship. How do people worship? Who do you worship? Where do you worship? You only have to look at what's going on in the Middle East today to see this same conflict going on almost. Our fathers say this is how to worship. You say that's how to worship. You know, but I remember actually Pastor Matty is a missionary friend of ours who lives in Oman, it's difficult to be a missionary for Christ in the Islamic world. But I remember one thing that he said, that he said when he was first there, how do you even get in there? You can't share your faith, it's against the law. But then God said to him, worship me. And what he did was he worshipped God in spirit and in truth. He worshipped the Father, he worshipped the Lord Jesus Christ. And then gradually they invited people to come and worship with him. And worshipping in the spirit and in truth was a way in. It's not about this rule, that rule, how it works out. It's not about all of the ins and outs. It's about me and my heart before the Lord Jesus Christ. Me and my heart before God, my Creator. You know, we will stand, actually, you know what? The passage we read, it's there. It's in there, isn't it? In that chapter of 2 Corinthians 5. Verse 10, we didn't read it, but "For we must all appear before the judgment seat of Christ, that everyone may receive the things done in his body according to that he hath done, whether it be good or bad." Wow. That's the thing, isn't it? We stand before God alone. We stand before Christ alone. That image there in this chapter is of one of reward. the Beamer seat. It's where the athletes got their medals. It's recognition. It's not about condemnation so much here. But that is the thing at the end of the day. Jesus said to the woman at the well, "You worship, you know not what. We know who we worship." Wow. Again, you might say, "Jesus, you can't say that to someone. That's very controversial. You can't say, well, you know, you don't know what you're worshiping." No, but Jesus says that to her. It's a good question for the world to ask itself today, for every one of us to ask ourselves today. Do we know who we are worshiping? Wow. Do we know who we are worshiping? Are we worshiping an ideology, a politician? Are we worshiping a famous person, celebrity? Now, a lot of people worship celebrity. I saw this thing today, and it was about this news article about the actor strike in Hollywood is over, apparently. And I thought to myself, I didn't even realise there wasn't. And it's like, you know, I have absolutely no idea and no interest, really. But it's like, but the thing is, like, people were saying, and I noticed underneath somebody had commented the same. And people were incredibly, you know, sort of, "What? So you live under a rock, you know, and like, you don't know what's going on in society at all. Who cares?" I said to the guy, "Actually, no, it just proves you have a life." You know, it's not. But I mean, this is the thing, it's like people worship celebrity. People worship all sorts of things. Do we know who we are worshipping? Wow. You know? Do we think we know who we're worshipping? Wow. Or will I worship Jesus? Yeah, you know what? Do we worship Jesus? Ooh. Well, you know, the Jesus I worship would be very accepting and compassionate in this situation. Wouldn't turn anyone away. You know what? There's one side. So the left wing Jesus accepts everything. Very welcome. Very it's all about compassion. Is that the real Jesus? And then the other side, the right wing side, it's where it's all about, "Oh no, Jesus would be standing up for truth. And actually, you know, going by the word and the letter of the law." You know, is that the real Jesus? Now, you know what? The point is, we need to ask Jesus. Let's never presume to know what Jesus would do in a situation. Oh, Jesus would be behind this course. Would he? Ask him. You know, this is the point. We need to be a people who are led by God's Spirit, who trust God's Word. A people of prayer, who just ask Jesus, you know, "Yeah, is this what you want? Is this how, you know, is this the way it should be?" Wow, just get to know him. That's the point. We need to be a people who are constantly getting to know him. However long we've walked with the Lord, however long we've been a Christian, we need to be a people who just are constantly getting to know him, discovering him. Wow. Huh.
Wow.
It's a big thing, isn't it, to say to the woman, "You worship, you know not what." Wow. First John 4:10 says, "Herein is love, not that we love God, but that he loved us and sent his Son to be the propitiation for our sins." so loved us, we ought also to love one another. Big word, propitiation, isn't it? Not something we talk about a lot. I do like the King James myself, but there we go. Yeah, it just means the atoning sacrifice, really. The payment. the thing that actually is sufficient for God to deal with sin. Yeah. He loved us. He gave himself for us. Wow. And he rose again.
Yeah.
That's the point, isn't it? That's the difference. Because he rose again, we're not going to a dead leader, to an ideology. We're not even going to a fixed thing, are we? It's not like, you know, well, yeah, actually I grew up in a church a bit like that, where it's like, you know, well, these are the hymns that were written, and anything after that, we're not going to sing, because they're too long. This is the way we worship, and no, we're not going over any newfangled ideas. You know what? No. Spirit of God is alive today.
Amen.
Spirit of God speaks to every generation. Jesus was there. You know, he didn't stop in 1832, or, you know, he didn't stop by the time of the Reformation. He didn't stop in the 1960s with the charismatic movement or whatever. You know, no, the Spirit of God moves on. Spirit of God is at work in us today. And you know what? We're a people who want to be in touch with God's Spirit and discovering the heart of Jesus Christ, because he loves us. And he's alive today. He rose from the dead, and he's still interceding at God's right hand for us. Wow. You're being prayed for today. We prayed for those children. We prayed for various things, like Aunt Sister today, and different situations going on. And you know what? The Lord Jesus Christ is interceding.
Amen.
However many people we pray for, however many people pray for us, and we're always grateful of people who pray for us. You know, that the Lord Jesus Christ, it tells us that he's seated at the right hand of the Father, and he's interceding for us. Wow. We thus judge if one died for all. If one died for all, then my past is gone, and I can be forgiven. If one died for all, I can trust him. I was thinking about this. How much did Jesus challenge people? We read that bit about the blind man and the disciples. Master, who sinned? Was it, you know, this man was born blind. Was that a result of his sin, or was it a result of his parents' sin, or, you know, what was the cause of it? Jesus says, no. The works of God are going to be manifest in his life. Actually, you know, he did a miracle, he healed him. But the works of God are manifest in people's lives, even without a healing sometimes, a physical healing, maybe with a spiritual healing. Remember the man who was lowered down from the roof, paralyzed, before Jesus said, oh, rise up and walk, he said, your sins are forgiven you. That was the biggest need. That was the thing, you know, get the spiritual healing first. And then maybe the physical healing comes after. But, you know, the disciples, they've been with Jesus, they still have these funny attitudes. You know, as believers, sometimes we have a funny attitude about something.
We do.
Yeah, it's like, you know, oh, that person needs to be in church. Yeah, okay, fine, good, yeah. And I've said that myself. And it is good for us to be in church. It's good for us to be together and things like that. And we miss out. I think it's more because we know that people are missing out if they're not here.
Yes.
That's the thing, isn't it? But it's because there's so much more than just the preaching. Yeah, you can get the preaching online. Okay, fine. But it's the community. It's the atmosphere. It's the worship.
Absolutely.
It's being together. It's the conversations after and before. And that's the thing. It's the whole thing. But you know what? It's like, you know, it's sometimes we have this time. Why is that person really drinking? No, you know. The heart of Jesus, that's the point. Get God's heart for someone. We get these funny attitudes, like the disciples, you know. I'm going to go and judge that person. No, go back and ask Jesus. And I was thinking about this. It's like, yes, you read through the book of John. John chapter 1, Jesus challenges Nathanael about his attitudes and things. And then John chapter 2, Jesus challenges his mother, Mary, at the wedding in Cana. John chapter 3, Jesus challenges Nicodemus about what he's doing. John chapter 4, Jesus challenges the woman at the well we just read about. John chapter 5, challenges the paralyzed man. 38 years waiting to be healed. Jesus heals him, and then he says, you know, go and sin no more, lest the worst thing come upon you. For goodness sake, Jesus, he's been paralyzed for 38 years. Go and sin no more, lest the worst thing come upon you.
Wow.
Jesus, you can't say that. You can't say that. You know, John chapter 6, Jesus challenges the crowd that have been following. Oh, you know, feeding the 5,000, yeah. And then he says, okay, eat my flesh and drink my blood. It's like, oh, that's a bit weird. But in a short time, they've all gone. It's like, oh, you know, and he says to the disciples, are you going to go away as well? Or are you going to accept what I say? Accept what I say even when you don't like it. John chapter 7, he challenges the people at the feast that he's gone to in the temple. Yeah, John chapter 8, he challenges the woman caught in adultery. John chapter 9, he challenges the disciples over this blind man that we just read. John chapter 10, he challenges the Pharisees over the fact that the blind man was healed and they didn't like it. And what's their heart towards it? John chapter 11, he challenges Mary and Martha. Do you believe that I'm the resurrection and the life? Could Lazarus come back? How much do you believe? Could God do a miracle? Teasing Nigel in the car on the way home the other day. He was talking about he has a key worker, a health worker, support worker and social worker. I said, yeah, I forget all them, just come to your miracle worker. I said, come to church and get with your miracle worker. Now that's the thing, isn't it? It's like, yeah, not that these people do any harm, but you know, maybe Jesus can do a bit better. But you know, but there we go, you know, it's like, yeah. John chapter 12. John chapter 13, he challenges Peter over the foot washing thing. And then, you know, it's like 14 through to 18, it's the prayer where he has that intimate time with the disciples. Well, actually, John chapter 14, he still challenges Philip, doesn't he? Then by 19, actually, he challenges Pilate to his face. John chapter 20, he challenges Thomas for doubting. John chapter 21, he challenges the seven disciples that have gone back fishing. You know, every time, don't get this image that gentle Jesus, meek and mild, Jesus is only going to pat me on the head and say the things I like. No. We get with Jesus, he's going to challenge you. He's going to challenge the way you think. He's going to say things that you don't like. He's going to surprise you. Wow. Well, I've always been a nice person. I tell you what, you've always been a sinner.
Yep.
That's true. It's like, you know what? You know, I hear this from people I work with, and it's like, yeah, you know what? That's not the point, is it? Oh, but you can't say that. That's a hate crime to tell me I'm a sinner. No, actually, it's not.
No, it's the truth.
It's the greatest act of love that anyone can do. To warn someone that they're a sinner and say, yes, but you know what? If Christ died, if one died for all, then he's all dead. You know what? We're all passing away. Christ died for us. Wow. And you know, what is the result? When we realize that actually, we need a Savior, we need Christ to have died for us. The result is we know no man after the flesh. Mm-hmm. And you know what? That's such a healing thing for us. Sometimes, you know, it's like, oh, it's a challenging thing, it's a difficult thing. But actually, you know what? It's for our benefit. Because when we know that Christ died for us, at our worst point, then we realize that he died for everyone else as well. And all these things, our past history, our guilt, our weaknesses, our failings, it's all gone, it's dealt with, it's forgiven. But also the things that have been done wrong to us. That person that, I know what they did. I remember what they did to me. You know what? We can let it go. We can let it go. Why? Because, well, you know, Christ died for that too. And it's like, well, yes, it might be a terrible thing. Might be a bad history. But you know what? Holding on to it is not going to do us any good. And Christ died for them. We don't know people after their flesh. We don't know people after their failings anymore. We don't know people in their past history. This is one of the reasons that we don't always keep bringing up our past history. You know, we don't have to. Because it's dead and it's buried. You know what? It's like, this whole idea that, oh yes, but I was a terrible person years ago. Yeah, yes, that's fine. I was a terrible person years ago. I still am a lot of the time. My wife is snickering away there because she knows it's true. But the point is this, you know, we're forgiven.
Amen.
I had to bring something to God the other day. I can't even remember what it was now. But God reminded me of something that I'd done probably about 20 years ago. And it sounds a bit weird, I know. I don't want to go through this. Well, I repent. No, it's not this big thing. But I just suddenly remember thinking about something that happened years and years ago. And I remember thinking, you know what? I don't think I ever did acknowledge that that was wrong. And I just, you know, I was in the bath the other day, and I was just lying there thinking, said to God, look, sorry for that. And it's funny because it actually was a little healing in my life that I didn't even know I needed. And it's like, yeah, you know what? It's true, you know. Because we're always going to find things that we need to bring to God. We're always going to remember things. And it's like, wow. But you know what? We don't know people after the flesh. Because my past is gone. Your past is gone. Mm-hmm. My neighbor's past is gone. It's like this whole idea. We live in a society that loves to bring up the past now. We live in a society that is actually the antithesis of Christianity. This is the point, isn't it? We've gone so far away from the Christian heritage that not only that people not understand it anymore or not believe it anymore, but we've got to the point where we actually are doing the exact opposite of what the Bible says. Rather than forgiving people, this idea that, well, you know, Sean, I looked at your Facebook profile and in 2009 you laughed at a joke that you shouldn't have. Crazy. What, you know, what's that about? That's ridiculous. That's lies as well. I don't know anything about you. I don't even know whether he was on Facebook in 2009. But it's like, you know, but that's what the world does today, isn't it?
Yeah, absolutely.
Oh, this politician, oh, they made this comment. You know, they need to resign because 42 years ago they made a silly comment. Who cares? You know, it's like that, but that's the way that we live. Oh, but I went to a psychologist and my psychologist told me that I need to go back and blame my parents for something that happened when my hamster died. It's like, you know what? Again, who cares? No, we don't know people after the flesh. And that's a healing. It's good for them because we don't bring the accusations. We don't bring the resentment and the bitterness against people. But it's good for us as well. Because we see people in their potential in the Lord Jesus Christ. And that's the thing. And when it says that he's given us a ministry of reconciliation, and a word of reconciliation, that's what this is about. It's about bringing people back together and saying, you know what, yes, this happened, but you know what, I'm in Christ. And you can be in Christ too.
Yeah.
You know, and it's like, you can choose that, and even if you don't choose that, I've still forgiven you. This is the point, isn't it? It's like, Christ died for your sin. Christ died for my sin. And there's healing and there's life there. And it's like this world doesn't understand it. You know. But we find people that understand it. The woman at the well didn't understand it initially, but by the end of the conversation she did. And she went and got all of her friends and all of the village and all the people that didn't like her and got them all together and pointed them to the Lord Jesus Christ. And it's like, yeah, that's it. Jesus, he challenged people. He constantly challenges people. He will challenge people. He'll challenge us still. But you know what the great thing is? If any man is in Christ, he is a new creature. All things are passed away. Behold, all things are become new. Wow. Yeah. That's it. What happened last week? What happened 25 years ago? I mean, I know none of you are old enough to remember 25 years ago. But you know, yeah, it doesn't matter. It's gone. It's forgiven. And there's this amazing divine exchange that Jesus Christ was made sin for us, that we could be made the righteousness of God in him. Wow. Christ as Saviour. It means that we receive the goodness of God in ourself, that we are justified because God looks at us and says, Christ died for her. And actually, now, when I look at Anne, I see the Lord Jesus Christ. I don't see her past. I don't see her issues. I see the Lord Jesus Christ. And any sins that Anne committed, she's grinning because I don't know the sins that Anne's committed. She knows the sins she's But that's between her and the Lord Jesus Christ.
Yeah.
Any sins that Anne committed.
Which one?
They are both. But anything that is gone there is gone unto Christ.
Amen.
And crucified. And buried. And gone. You know, if we bring up our past, we bring up other people's past. What's that like? It's like digging up an old corpse. A stinking body that has been rotting from the grave for it. That's the idea, and that's what it's saying here. That is it. It's dead. It's gone. Gone forever. Heavenly Father, we just thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord, that you're the God who challenges us. Lord, we don't presume to know your heart, to know your ideas, your opinions on anything. But we seek your heart. We want to know you. We want to get to know you. We want to hear from you, Lord. We want to be challenged by you because you're the God who challenges people. Challenges the normality, challenges the things that we take for granted. But we thank you, Lord, that because you died for us, the old attitudes, the old ideas, they don't have to rule us anymore. They're gone. Our past doesn't have to be our focus anymore because you died for it. You forgave us. Gave us life. Our future doesn't have to be a worry anymore because we can be secure in you. And even if we face the people who wronged us, even if we face situations that daunt us, we have you with us. We have your strength, we have your spirit, we have your life. We have a God who goes before us. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord, that our past is dealt with, our future is secure. We have the present to live in your presence.
Yes, God.
To get to know you. Thank you, Lord. And Lord, we pray, is anyone out there watching? Anyone who has never trusted the Lord Jesus as their Saviour, never invited him into their heart. Lord, we just pray that this would be the time when they can say, Lord, I know that I need a Saviour. I know that I've done wrong. I know that I've not been perfect. But I also know that you forgive me. You died for me. And I trust that your death on the cross pays for my sin. Takes care of my past, the guilt, the hurt and the wounds, and also takes care of the wrongs that people have done to me. And I trust you, Lord. And I invite you to be my Saviour. And I give my heart to you, Lord, in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ. Amen.
Amen.
And if you watch said that prayer for the first time, let somebody know. It doesn't have to be me, but just tell someone. Worship.